Okay, so let's move on. And now we have Maren, who is going to give us a talk that is almost done, update on the observing campaign and data prediction for the VVV and VVVX.
Okay, so full screen mode. I do it the same way. I woke up at 4 o'clock, so I'm not moving away from my coffee. Sorry. Okay. Thanks as well for organizing the meeting here. As Thunder pointed out, and as the title says, we are almost done with the survey. And in the next 25 minutes, I'm going to tell you just how much has been done and what we still all have waiting for us and what that might actually mean for some of the work that's been done, especially on the variability. And I also can tell you a little bit how to get data if you need some. Okay. So this is the complete VVV, VVVX area. So the red parts, that's VVV. Everything else is VVVX. Just as a reminder, that area called bulge high was added by Elena Valenti because we wanted to have the bulge area symmetric, which was originally VVV, goes from minus 10 to plus 5. So we added 5 to 10. Then somebody came along and wanted to include the Sagittarius, so now we are starting from minus 15 to minus 10. This plus 20, that's a green area, was added the same way as this 230 to complete the circle with the UKIDS galactic plane survey. So when everything is done, we have an almost, or we have a complete disk image. It was one of the very helpful selling points to ESO, because that will increase the legacy value of the survey, because it makes it so very valuable to everybody else working on the galactic plane. The same is true for this high and this low. My apologies for the less than invented names, but just made it a bit easier. And they connect the VVVX to the VHS survey, but not, in case you're wondering, completely.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, our problem is, or not our problem, fact is our tires are orientated in longitude and latitudes, and VHS and RA and DEC. So there is a tiny little gap between the tiles. Okay. We couldn't really add an additional row to make the overlap complete, because that would have meant we add 166 ties, and that adds a lot of time if it comes to that. So if more delays are coming, we could discuss whether this would be an option, but there are so many other things that would also be options. It's up for discussion, actually. So bulge and disk, they only got a few extra epochs to extend the time baseline. Originally, the proposal, or in the letter of intent, we asked for 3,000 hours, which for some reason ESO cut down to 2,000. Might have to do with the fact that there were only 7,500 hours available, and there were 4 other surveys, and some left over time from the previous surveys, so we had to cut down in epochs, and we also had to sacrifice Y and Z photometry for the new areas. So this plus 20, that's a green one, the bulge high and low, and the disk high and low only get 23 epochs plus 1 extra epoch from the multicolor observations. Okay, so 24 epochs, and this 230 gets 38 epochs plus the 1 from the multicolor. Okay, so in the proposal, the observations were supposed to start in P98, which was the summer semester, and then go for 3 years. Same way as the VVV survey, we tried to get the multicolor observations out of the system first, because that would allow us to do stellar population studies, CMDs, and NNNN, and then do the epochs over the rest of the years. And then winter came, have to be said. And that was winter 2016, which was way before the survey started. And the weather was so bad that ESO was running, or Vista was running empty for half the nights. So ESO asked us, okay, can we submit early? And that's what we did. Because if you remember the proposal, we can do part of the observations in K-band under slightly relaxed seeing constraints. So we don't need the 1 arc second seeing. We do half of the epochs under free seeing, which ESO liking numbers means the constraint is 2 arc seconds. If you look at the data, you will find there is hardly anything worse than 1.5, 1.6 but officially we could have a few epochs, a few images where the seeing is not quite as good.
So between having the proposal accepted and the survey management plan, as I said, winter happened, winter came. So we didn't start in P98, we started in 97. Well, it's called carry under. We started with a lot of K-band because, as I said, we can have worse seeing. But because we were playing nice and setting it early, we also got some good seeing exposures, so we could add some JH and K imaging. Unfortunately, there was no P98. We're still not starting surveys. So we have P97, 1 year later, another winter semester, and then only then we started with the summer. And it also changed to the survey management plan that we now had P109, which is, or which will be, the upcoming summer, starting in October until April next year. Okay. So also we had to change the distribution of the JH and K imaging because that's done under spectral seeing constraints, and ESO didn't want us to occupy 3 semesters completely under good seeing, so we had to mix it up a little bit. Unfortunately, then also came winter 2017 to 2018, and then it became very interesting. So the top one is what we thought we would be doing in the survey. The lower one is actually what we finally submitted for each semester. Okay, so 97 got a few epochs out of the way, a little bit. Then next winter, P109, P100 was the first summer semester. We are currently in P103. 104 has just been submitted in August. We'll get fewer summer targets, the outer regions of disk, or we'll get the outer regions of disk high and low, and variability for this 230. We still have a little bit of time left, and since it's officially summertime, what we are still missing, that would be P106, which ESO told us will be halfway available for Vista surveys. And then, depending on what the situation is, they might stop and get started working on Foremost. What the exact timing is, I'm not really sure ESO knows. There will be a workshop in December in Santiago on Foremost, so they might have a better schedule for that. Summer and winter target is a little bit of a gray zone because we actually could shift some of the areas from the summer targets to the winter. The problem is the time windows get very narrow, and ESO has limits. How much time has to be available to actually push a target in there? So we have to work. It has to be, it will require fine tuning, let's put it this way. But we could do that. Where are we at the moment? So let's start from the bottom. VVV is finished, except a few additional areas, since it's part of VVVX as well, where we get a few extra epochs. Okay. So the first runs are all finished. That was P97. This is P99, where we got 200 hours, and all of a sudden they ask us, can you send us 200 hours more, which is why the winter targets were almost finished very early on. Okay, summer started later, but all of that has been completed. Completed means it has been accepted, being within observing constraints by ESO. Okay, so it does not include the final quality control filters for the data release. So there will be some observations that have to be repeated anyway. At the moment, the runs running are, is this one, it's almost finished. The data are from July 13th, so this one might actually already be done. The ongoing run is this one. The small ones here with 23.3 and 9 hours are observations that have been graded D, meaning there are a couple of exposures that are not exactly within constraints. And so far, we always got permission to repeat them without additional checking, because we cut down on epochs. We only do the JH and K ones, so ESO allowed us, we can automatically send them back. That always worked, so we will have all of the data within constraints once the graded D observations have been repeated. As I said, in August, we submitted more OBs. That's a number of 272 hours. It includes this 230 and this low and high. They are now in the queue. And as soon as summer semester starts, it will be in November, they hopefully will start observing. Unfortunately, this run has still almost 50% in the queue. So it hasn't been completed because this year there was mirror coating, a couple of technical issues, so we lost a lot of time. And when all is said and done, we have 130 hours for P105, 106 left, and that's it. So what's a VVV reality? So this is a bulge, bulge low, bulge high, and my apologies, you can't read the numbers. If you can, we have 25, 24 epochs. The numbers vary a little bit because of the grade D OBs. They're officially accepted, but not within specifications. So they are repeated. So the numbers are slightly higher. For most of them, it's 24. There are a couple of tiles where it's 25, 26. And we even have a few tiles that just pop up as grade D. And there are even more epochs. Okay. But pretty much these areas are done. There might be one or two tiles or concatenations that need to be repeated because of the grade D, but these areas are finished and pretty much have the maximum epochs, which is 74 for most of the red bulge area, except the innermost plus minus 2 degrees because they get 9 more epochs, so they have a little bit more. And the ones you really want to look out for is tile 293, 4, 5, 6, and 307, 8, 9, 10, because they have 310 epochs right now. It's where Bardis window is, so we like selected this one with highly populated light curves to also build the templates for the variability studies. And blue and green, the low 24 epochs, plus one or two for the grade B. The disk is also almost done. There's still an epoch in the queue that has been submitted because we added 9 more epochs in VVVX. And the inner part of this low and high is also done. Again, with the exception of, it has all been submitted. Problems are the great DOBs, which are a little bit random. Okay. Doesn't look quite so well for the disk 230. It gets 38 epochs and we are less than halfway through. We just submitted 13 more epochs and then there are 7 left for the area. Okay. What's done for all of the areas are the multicolor observations. Okay. Except for the grade D again, and there's one tile, I probably mentioned this later, yeah, which I will mention later. That's if you work on disk 20, there's one tile, 947, that doesn't have a counterpart in grade D. So we haven't had the chance to repeat it. So we have to check out whether we can combine this with an accepted tile to repeat those observations. The data for this one tile are not within constraints, not as they are available now. So these are the plots that are usually put on a website that Joyce is maintaining and running, showing you what the time delay is between two consecutive epochs. So the scatter you see on top is because of the grade D OBs, because they get combined with other tiles and repeated. So it's not as smooth as it was used to be at the beginning. These are the 8 tiles we combine in the high cadence. Area, and these are the tiles plus minus 2 degrees in the bulge because they also have a little bit more. This one tile and these two tiles is actually what was included in science verification, so they got 10 early epochs. That's why they have a little bit higher. That's the bulge, that's the disk, that is low bulge, high bulge. And these are the plots for this 230, which is much lower. And this is the high and the low disk. This is the outer part, which lags behind. This is the inner part, which is already completed more or less. And this is disk 20. Okay. So there is a problem with that since our observations can't have a fixed cadence. It's just how the observing tool works. you have to live with the fact that our ties are combined in concatenation, so we can't set fixed time delays between consecutive observations. And that puts a limit on how many epochs do we need to allow us to detect the variables properly. István Dekani did a lot of work on that, and he modeled how many epochs randomly distributed do we need to reach fixed cumulative detection efficiency. And did this for 20, 30, 40, 60, 80 epochs, and calculated what the efficiency would be to detect variables efficiently. Okay. So this would be for 20 epochs. Okay. And with as an example, with a given period, reddening and an NNN, assuming what happens if you have 20. Okay, so the detection efficiency is actually pretty low, which puts some constraints on the VVX area because we are only exceeding this by a little bit. We did this for 40, which looks pretty good, meaning if we can reach 40 epochs, we can get very high detection efficiencies. And 80, of course, would be the best scenario we can get. Okay. So, however, that does not include that we have to subtract the false detections. And it also does not exclude bad seeing. You're just not detecting the variables to begin with, although they're actually there. He also calculated what the false detection efficiency would be. This one is for 20, and this one is for 80 again. So you can reduce the false detections by a lot. There has been a new work by Carlos Eduardo. He is also working on efficiency on how well to detect variables, but it's an ongoing work. I think he started writing the paper on Viva survey, Viva project. I guess sooner or later they'll show up on AstroPH. It's going to be very interesting because he uses a much larger data sample. How does VVV compare to that? That plot is some random selected bulge tiles where I just checked how many epochs do we have per given year, in the same way the models work here. The black one, that's type 307, it's in the high cadence area, so it has more than 300 epochs, so that's actually really nice. The disk is this one, it's, when it's finished, it's now 54 epochs for the disk, and this is this plus 20. So the bulge, the disk do pretty good. The new VVX areas, we will probably have to live with the fact that the detection efficiency is not really in comparison to the original VVV. But perhaps forms isolate more, and then we can talk about this. So the models he did were for RAGs only, so that comparison has to be taken with a grain of salt. Again, VVV area does pretty well. VVVX comes with a little drawback that we don't have as many epochs. What's really bad for that, especially for the VVV areas, is that if you have clumped observations. So I went through the data and I only found one concatenation, that's 10 tiles in the low disk area that actually had 5 observations done consecutively in one night. Yeah. I haven't found any more. If you ever come across that, let me know, because we requested that we don't have more than 2 observations and certainly not consecutively. Okay, because with only 24 epochs, that is quite a blow to the variability study. So what we did with those 10 tiles, we just said we consider the 3 tiles in the middle as failed observations and we send them back as grade D. So they are back in the queue. We should get those observations. And ISO did not complain. So, a little bit about the pipeline. I'm not sure who of you is using the pipeline directly. I only used a small fraction of it for the completeness test. So you can add your stars and run the photometry the same way Kazu does it. But you can download the pipeline if you want to reduce the data by yourself. Okay. Considering that the data by now, at least the tile images, the stacked images, and the catalogs add up to roughly 100 terabytes, Good luck with that. The only thing you need to do is tell CASU who you are and that you would like to download the data. They check whether you're in the survey, and that's pretty much it. And they send you the link to download the pipeline. Okay. It does the image tagging, it removes large scale structures, it provides the catalogs, it does the astrometry. As I said, I only use one of the packages that's the photometry. Okay. That works on the reduced stacked images or the tile images. So if you want to do your own completeness test, you add your artificial stars and then import with the same settings as CASU does it. And then you have pretty much the same type of photometry you can compare. There is a new version of the pipeline. It's 1.5. CASU usually runs all the data through the new pipeline. So we right now, so all the VVVX data have been reduced with that pipeline from the beginning, and CASU has been running backwards to re-reduce the VVV data with the new pipeline as well. There is a small 0 point offset for the detector images that's in the 1-2% level. If somebody works with tiles, it's a little bit more. So the tiles are more difficult because of the 0 points between the different paw prints. I don't really know many people who work with tiles, but if you do, you might be interested in downloading the new version. I think it's all done now. I'm still downloading 2010. It just takes a while, but everything starting from 2017 is already done. And since we talked about data retrieval, so we have all the data at Catholica. It's a big server. If you need data, you can actually look in your CASU, see which files you need, and then we can talk about how to copy them somewhere where you can retrieve them. Be aware that we can't send you 50 terabytes of data. So if you have a specific tile, you can go to the database, check which files you need, and then we find those data and put them in a directory or download. But there is an upper limit to how much. It's not just that it's not exactly exciting to do that. It's also our internet is not the fastest. So 20 terabytes. I'm still downloading data for 2010, and I started the download on July 7th. Okay, I'm still running. What's the next one? That's pretty much it. That's one thing which I wasn't even sure whether I should include this. So the CASU pipeline obviously does a very good job. Okay, so CASU people, it's aperture photometry. So if you use PSF, talk to Javier or Francesco. There is, however, just for completeness, WebCam is also included in the Feli pipeline. No. So if you have a small subsample, you can also try, because that allows you to co-add the images. So if you want to co-add all the K-band that's available for one tier, you want to do it by yourself, that can be done in Feli. Okay. Feli pipeline, that's by Misha Schirmer. He did pipelines for imaging instruments all over. Doesn't have anything better to do, it seems. And it actually, for a year now, it also includes WebCam. There's no, you do complementary spectroscopy, doesn't exist yet, but it has a very wide range of imaging instruments, and WebCam is now also included. Okay. If I remember correctly, VSA does the merged catalogs. It also does the deep catalogs, but I don't think they provide the co-edit images. Mm-hmm. If you want to combine all 300 epochs, for instance, for the 8 tiles and the bulge, because you want to go for background galaxies, you might want to be interested in that, then that would be an option to think about.
Do they do this for the tile, for the stack image, for?
You would have to get the raw images.
Okay.
So which means, because it does astrometry and photometry and the bias abstraction, so you start really from the raw data, which I think are available 1 or 2 days after the observing has been done, because it's no CASU involved.
Mm-hmm. We can get it from the ESO archive for raw data.
So, but I use it on other data sets. Mm-hmm. It works very well but it is also very CPU intensive. Okay. But that's the same, that's always going to be a problem for this data.
You can use MStack and the Castor tools, right? I mean, the Castor MStack routine will also stack everything.
I never tried it. When I came along the CD pipeline, I just thought I should mention it because if you work on small data sets, on a very small subsample, then that might be also be interesting. Okay. Mm. And that's pretty much it. Have fun with the data.
Thank you so much, Maren, for the update. Any comments, questions?
I just had one small comment on to figure what you said about downloading the data. It's often there's this additional CASU program called FITS. Is it FITS.io list? FITS.io list or something, which is a Fortran script, which is quite useful just to turn the 80 columns of data into the 6 columns you need: RADEC, X and Y, and magnitude. While it's doing that, it also does a saturation correction for all the saturated stars, which is the most valuable thing because often the one you want is it's periodic and it's variable, can be saturated some of the time. So it's just worth being aware of that as a helpful little tool.
Maren, one question. So in the VVVX, there's going to be only one multicolor set, so 1J, 1H.
For most of them, yes.
Okay.
For the plus minus 2 degrees in the bulge, we get people data because we had to fill, we got a fixed amount of hours for a given semester, and there was 2 hours we couldn't fill with an additional epoch for everything. So we used those 2 hours to add more J and more H band to force it a little bit deeper. But the general rule is, I guess, so there is a limit in how long a container can be at ESO. That's 1 hour, 5 minutes. Okay. And with the exposure times we had to split the J, H, and K exposures. So you're doing J, H, and K. And then we do an additional 60 seconds in J because we couldn't fit it in without exceeding the 1 hour, 5 minutes limit. Well, we're exceeding it by 24 seconds, but that's within the waveform. But there is 60 seconds of J band that come independently because we couldn't fit it in. So there's no, they are not linked. So the time delay between the JH and K and additional J is completely random from time to time. So that only helps for photometric depths.
Yeah.
So it's only 2 epochs in J extra. Doesn't help, but for the depth of the data, it might be useful.
Yeah, this is an interesting point because what limits the color microdiagrams is the depth in J. And so if there is more time available, if one option is to do the ZY filters in the VVVX area that we don't have, but another option would be to do deeper J and H band observations. Or another option might be to do more epochs, which we need for the variables. So we don't know if there will be extra time, but sooner or later we will have, if there is, we will have to decide and fast.
Okay.
So,
but in this case, if you want, for example, to study some specific kind of stellar populations, and let's say in the other side of the galaxy, we would need very good color.
Just want to say we have Carlos and Lei online. Carlos has a comment.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, so hello. So just following up a bit on a couple of things Maren mentioned that might pop up later on. As you said, Maren, version 1.5 is finished. So we have run completely through the whole backlog of observations. And they should be already in Edinburgh as we speak. I mean, there might be the odd tile that might need some manual fixing because whatever reason. But pretty much this should be done. It is done. So yeah, that's completely finished. And also regarding this stacking, this is something we actually already do in CASU. So if there is a need for us to stack some of or all the VVV data to get deep ties or deep stacks, whatever you want, this is something that can be done if there is need for that.
It's depressing that you are reducing all the data faster than we can download them.
It should be a little bit more efficient to stack and then download and then stack.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. How much time would you need to stack all the stacks?
I don't know really. I would need to do some tests.
Okay.
I don't think it would be too bad.
Okay.
Actually. Because the way, I mean, this is something, for example, we do for one of the other surveys, Veils. Mm-hmm. The way we do it, I mean, this is largely a memory problem. Mm-hmm. So the way we do is we do deep stacks and then we do one big tile from the deep stacks.
Okay.
So essentially you only need to have, you know, 100 detectors in memory instead of like having like 100 tiles. So it's not as bad as it might look, but it still is. I mean, if you really have the need for this, I can give you an estimation. I can do run some tests with, you know, a handful of tiles and see how long it takes and then scale from there.
Okay.
Because, I mean, one of the obvious uses for this is to feed photometry. So you can do the deep tile, then do your object search there, and then use that to fit like single epoch photometry.
Is there the option of selecting the best PSF ones? Because in general, it's much better than stacking everything.
Yeah.
So this is something that that you might want to give it a thought. Like, how would you like to do this?
Yeah.
Like, where do we do the, you know, everything that is below 1 arc second, for example, or what do you want, or you know, the best 50 epochs, or what do you want to do?
Right.
Okay. This can be
very excellent. Good. Thank you.
Yeah. No problem.
Is there anyone else?
I just have a question on in terms of the data deliveries. I mean, has VVV as a team sort of done a recommended band merge with Gaia DR2? Or is this sort of, you know, like where all the VVV data in the catalog has sort of been matched to Gaia DR2?
Yes.
Or is that available and where?
Well, Lee's going to give a talk on VVVX2, I think it's Wednesday, is it his talk? So he's ported all of the VVV data onto the Gaia DR2 astrometric system. I don't think he's actually band merged it with Gaia, but he's used the Gaia stars as control stars in the astrometric fit. So in that sense, it's astrometrically on that system. He just hasn't added in the G magnitudes or parallaxes in that sense. That's what you mean.
Yeah, so for instance, you wouldn't have the parallax information in VRAC.
Well, there is, because that we do, but VVV parallax information, not Gaia parallax information.
Right.
But it's on the Gaia system.
So it's on the Gaia system. But
yeah.
But when you have a sources that are in the Gaia list and in the VRAC, in the VVV list, they get the same parallax?
Well, obviously the error is going to be different on two surveys, right? Because Gaia is much more precise
right.
than that. So yeah.
But when they're matched, so you've lost some information there then, right? On the because you're not using the Gaia parallax for a source that you know matches the VVV source. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
No, we're not. No, it's an independent thing.
Okay.
Yeah. But they do.
Lei is unmuted and ready to answer.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, I mean, I think Phil answered everything.
Thanks. I have just a comment. I made that match. I matched all the VVV DR2 with Gaia DR2. So I have here in this computer the 5 VVV magnitudes, the 3 Gaia magnitudes, proper motions, and
Bilejeune's distances.
Ah, and also I combined the Bilejeune distance, so I have everything in a single catalog.
Okay.
In case you are interested, it's a huge catalog that you can play around.
Right. And I think that in the BSA webpage, I think that they also match the PSF photometry with the with Gaia. There is a catalog there that they produce in Edinburgh, merging both.
So there's a separate pre-merged catalog of VVV and VVV PSF photometry with the Gaia that can be downloaded.
I am not positive, but I think that they did something like that. Okay.